Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the QT Intellectual Property Innovation Law Research Program and latest event, which is a seminar and a book launch by Dr. Catherine Bond from the University of New South Wales on Anzac, the Landing, the Legend and the Law. As is always the case at QUT, we'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands where QUT now stands, pay respect to their elders, past, present and emerging, and acknowledge the important role Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people community play within the QUT community. It's particularly apposite thinking about the Anzac story, having been to a number of exhibitions of late in Australia and New Zealand, which are very kind of interested in some of the Indigenous stories about the Anzac legend. We're delighted to have Dr. Catherine Bond here today. We have known Dr. Catherine Bond for quite a while now and have really loved the evolution and the arc of her research. I remember initially kind of having some engagements with her doing work on copyright law and policy, and it's wonderful to see that her industrious work in the area has pushed on to an exciting new kind of territory in terms of legal history and thinking about some of the battles in relation to legal questions about national icons like the Anzac legend. The book is an amazingly modular piece of work. In many ways, it's a microhistory. It encapsulates great grand themes about law and history and commerce and business within a kind of a very intent little capsule. And in other ways, it seems like a kind of a mega history as well. It kind of tells really the story of Australia in many different ways and how it has dealt with certain aspects of its history, which have then been rarefied in various different ways. And it's quite a beguiling book in terms of the shifts that it has in terms of its methodologies. So in some ways we could kind of read it as a kind of a book which is about intellectual property and intellectual property law, but equally it could be seen as a kind of a meditation upon the birth of Australian law and nationhood and the development of certain sorts of methodologies. There's also a very kind of strong theme throughout the work in terms of the commercial exploitation of certain nationalistic icons in various different ways. So without further ado, we are going to invite Catherine Bond to give us the greatest hits from her work, and then after that we'll open it up for some a question and answer session in terms of some queries and thoughts that people might have. So Dr. Catherine Bond.
Thank you, Matthew, for that introduction, and thank you so much for having me here this evening as well. I'm thrilled to be up here at QUT. It's the first time I've been to this beautiful campus, and it's a lovely place to spend a Wednesday evening, I think. So today I'm going to tell you about this little book I've written, and as Matthew says, it goes across 100 years of Australian history, legal history, commerce, the evolving Australia or the developing and evolving Australia, the constitution, our legal system, power, executive power, abuse of power and everything in between. So I wanted to start off, whereabouts am I pointing that? I'm just going to continue to... Oh, is it on? Oh, do I need to switch it on, in fact? Oh, there we go. Excellent. Slight technical difficulties, but we're there now. Excellent. So I wanted to start off by telling you a little bit about this current project. And so since about 2012, I had... In 2012, I had a kind of one of those kind of light bulb moments where... I realised that I wanted to, that no one had previously investigated, and that one of the things I wanted to do was move into looking at the relationship between intellectual property and war, and how intellectual property had affected wars, both from the start of World War One through to today. So how intellectual property played a role in World War One, World War Two, the Cold War, and then more recently on the War on Terror. And in 2014, I received a fellowship from my faculty to spend 6 months exploring this in more detail. And Anzac at that point hadn't even crossed my mind, or Anzac as a topic of legal research at that point hadn't even crossed my mind. It wasn't until I requested a group of items from the National Archive of Australia that I actually realised that this was an area of significant regulation. So even before 2014, I probably realised cursory in my teaching that you couldn't register a trademark that has the word Anzac in it, but I hadn't really made a connection between the legal regulation of that word and where that had come from and what that meant more generally. So in that series of files, there were a number of letters in those files written by family members of serving soldiers or soldiers who had died overseas, including many at Gallipoli, who were asking the government permission to name their homes Anzac. And later I counted these all up and there were just over 70, and in all cases these applications were denied. So these people poured, these individuals, mothers, fathers, wives, brothers, sisters, really poured their hearts out in these letters to the Minister for Defence and the Prime Minister and the Governor General and the Attorney General, only to receive a very short reply back from our Solicitor General at the time, Robert Garran, that he regretted that their request could not be granted. So I started to do a bit more digging into this idea, and it wasn't until just after the events of the 2015 commemoration and everything that went with that, that I decided to do further work in this area and ultimately turn this work into a book. So many of you who are Brisbane or Australia-based will likely remember a number of the quite disastrous public relations issues that occurred around the centenary of the Gallipoli commemoration, the Gallipoli landing in 2015, in April 2015. One of these are the Fresh in Our Memories campaign by Woolworths. Woolworths created what we might think of as a meme generator. They allowed people to upload a photo to their website and it would be overlaid with this memory, lest we forget, Anzac 1915 to 2015, Fresh in Our Memories. Fresh being part of the Woolworths Fresh Food People slogan. There were a number of problems with this. The first is that never let people upload things onto the internet is probably the first one. You can see there that a number of people used this generator in very comedic ways, others to make statements. So first, the problem with the internet generally. Second, the association of the Woolworths slogan, the Fresh Food People, with Anzac commemoration really rubbed the community the wrong way. This was felt to be inappropriate. But the third issue, and most significant for what I was thinking about, was the fact that it was revealed Woolworths hadn't got permission from the Minister for Veterans Affairs in order to use the word Anzac. Because if you want to use the word Anzac commercially, you today have to get permission from the Minister for Veterans Affairs. Similarly, Zoo Weekly released a special, or was planning to release a special Anzac centenary issue featuring a woman in a model in a bikini with a poppy. Before they could even release the issue, I was actually going to buy Zoo Weekly. I'm not going to lie. This was going to be an excellent research tool, and I realise this is being filmed. But before they could even release this copy of That Lad's magazine, they decided to pull it because of the public backlash. And then we saw the situation with Camp Gallipoli and Target. Now, Target and Camp Gallipoli had received permission from the Department of Veterans Affairs to use the term Anzac on a variety of merchandise, Camp Gallipoli being a being a kind of sleepover festival where you would stay the night at a showground, for example, and in the morning you would attend the last post. Sorry, not the last post. You would attend the dawn sense, the dawn service at that, at the local venue, at that local venue. But there was a bit of backlash to the fact that on some of their items they were using the word Anzac very prominently, like in the jumper there. So this led me to ultimately decide to pull all these different threads together into this book, Anzac, the Landing, the Legend, the Lore. And as has been mentioned, this book traverses a lot of different topics. But the topic that I want to focus on today is not Target, it's not Woolworths, it's Anzac biscuits. Because the legal regulation of Anzac actually has an interesting connection to the humble Australian Anzac biscuit. For those of you not familiar with them, there are there's a box and a couple of others over there. And today I'm going to tell you a bit about the book and the content of the book by tracking the development of the legal regulation of Anzac and the development of the Australian cultural item that is the Anzac biscuit. So just a bit of brief history for those not familiar. So Anzac itself comes from that acronym, the Australian and New Zealand Army Corps. There's who created the Anzac acronym and where the Anzac biscuit came from. Both of these have achieved an almost urban legend status, with multiple parties claiming that they were responsible for coining the name Anzac or creating the Anzac biscuit. Anzac, almost immediately after the landing at Gallipoli on the 25th of April 1915, and shortly after when news reports came to hit Australia with this information, the word Anzac took on a lot of significance within the community, and it became this new, it became this common word. It went from an acronym to a word in regular usage in that lowercase form that I use throughout the book in this presentation. It took on that meaning of the word Anzac was synonymous with mateship, with courage, with sacrifice. And so being an Anzac meant that you had these qualities about you. And that will be important later on when I talk about soldiers' use of the term. So 4th of August 1914, UK declares war on Germany. Australia joins shortly thereafter. Sometime in 1914 to 1915, likely early 1915, that term Anzac is created. And then the 25th of April 1915, Australia and New Zealand troops land at Gallipoli. The first news report comes to Australia on the 8th of May, and it's written by Ellis Ashmead Bartlett, published in the Argus, who decries how the Australians rose to the occasion of this landing. They didn't land in the correct spot, but when they got to the ground, they certainly didn't hold back. And this created a lot of joy for the developing Australian nation back home. It's just a few things on Anzac biscuits then, in parallel. So the Anzac biscuits that we eat today are not the ones that they ate at Gallipoli. Rather, they ate these hardtack biscuits, which were apparently so hard, they were basically not consumable. So here someone has turned one of these biscuits into a greeting card. And this is in the collection of the Australian War Memorial today. So the biscuits that were eaten at Gallipoli were not the kind of yummy supermarket or homemade biscuits that we eat today. And as I said before, there are a lot of questions about who kind of came up with these. Early recipes start appearing in newspapers in the 1920s. But in one of his pieces, Ken Inglis, the significant Australian historian, ties the Anzac biscuit to legal regulation of the term Anzac. He says that because of the fact that people couldn't commercially sell Anzac biscuits without receiving permission under this law, because of that, they were never marketed as such commercially and became a kind of folk food, a people's biscuit. And I'm going to spoil the ending of the story a bit, because from the movement of Anzac becoming a kind of folk food, a people's biscuit that they would make at home by themselves, as they became a more commercial product, so did the word Anzac itself. So we can track from the early 2000s an increased number of commercial Anzac biscuit enterprises, and with that we can see an increased commercialization of the word itself. So I want to tell you a little bit about the background to regulation. And as I said before, at this point in time, Anzac biscuits were not a thing per se. People weren't baking Anzac biscuits to sell money to raise funds for the troops. People in 1915, 1916 were not seeking to use the name Anzac on Anzac biscuits, but they were doing it in a whole variety of other ways. So almost immediately after the Gallipoli landing, people began to use the word Anzac in trade. The first trademark registration that incorporated the word Anzac was on the 8th of July 1915 in relation to furniture. A number of parties tried to register Anzac trademarks or trademarks incorporating that word Anzac, including everyone from Kodak. They wanted to register the word Anzac in relation to photography, through to games manufacturers, weapons manufacturers, and everything in between. So we see here some of the examples of how people were using the word Anzac in business. They were using it in badges. So companies were very keen on being able to manufacture and sell badges with the word Anzac. It was felt that people would want to buy these things. They could wear an Anzac badge and indicate that they had a family member serving overseas. There were Anzac songs. Anzac's Forever is a song. And there were multiple songs about Anzac and incorporating this word. And then there was the Anzac autograph album, an autograph book that you could get soldiers to sign. And there was an Anzac birthday book. There were cafes. There were restaurants named Anzac. There were hotels named Anzac. And everything in between. So as I said before, one of the greatest indicators we get about how Anzac was being used in the community is from the Australian Official Journal of Trademarks. And we see there were about 60 trademark registrations or attempts to register Anzac as a trademark up until about April 1916. Because around that time of that first, what we might think of as the first Anzac Day, there began to be a lot of backlash in the community about this use of Anzac. So there was both backlash and there was also a lot of discussion about how the term should be able to be used. Soldiers and some family members, for the most part, wanted to be able to use the term in recognition of service. In contrast, other family members sometimes said that they didn't think it was appropriate to be used at all. There's a very sad letter that I extract at the start of the book, a woman who called herself a mother of Anzacs and who was against the naming of a rail line in Woolloomooloo as Anzac. And she said that it should just be kept in quiet reverence by the mothers for all time. But it was clear that something needed to be done regarding this use of Anzac in the community. And there were a number of newspaper articles to this extent, And eventually it was actually the Queensland War Council who got in touch with their other state war councils and said, look, we need to do something about this use of Anzac. They made the recommendation to the federal government, and shortly thereafter the federal government decided to introduce a regulation to restrict the use of Anzac in trade. Now, this brings up our, or this brings to the foreground our first experience with the most dominant politician in Australia at the time, William Hughes, who was our Prime Minister and Attorney General, and his second in charge, Robert Garran, a public servant who was mild-mannered, tall, in contrast to the steamy, short stature of Billy Hughes. Robert Garran and William Hughes, in their various roles, were responsible for most of the laws passed in Australia during World War I. For the most part, these laws were written by Robert Garran in his role as Secretary and then Solicitor General of the Federal Attorney General's Department. And this includes the first regulation made regarding the use of, first and second regulations regarding the use of Anzac. So these were regulations, they were not laws, they, in the sense that they were not laws debated before Parliament. They were passed under the, or they were created pursuant to the War Precautions Act, which gave incredibly large powers to the Governor General to make regulations in respect of any area of Australian life that he felt, that the Governor General felt necessary to regulate during the time of war. And this included everything from what could appear in newspapers to what could, to the price of bread and other staple products, through to the regulation, ultimately, of the word Anzac. So in May 1916, this regulation was created, prohibiting the use of Anzac both as the name of a business or on goods without the permission of the Governor General. All trademark registrations that had been made in relation to that name had to be cancelled, and no company could register Anzac as a business name. So from the 1st of July, it would not be possible to use the word Anzac in trade as a business name or on goods. Now, this didn't stop a large number of individuals seeking to get special permission from the government to use Anzac in trade. And for the most part, these were denied. So for example, one company, Hicks and Wrench, they applied to the Attorney General to use the word Anzac on the basis that they had already printed up thousands of labels for their Anzac, for their product, the Anzac BT. But they were told, you can't sell this product. So what would actually happen is the tea labelled with Anzac BT would be imported into Australia. Once it got to Australia, Hicks and Wrench would be responsible for relabeling this tea. However, they got into a bit of trouble because on one occasion, 5 crates of tea got stolen and they were still in their original packaging. But rather than the police investigate the theft, when it was reported, the police instead investigated their use of Anzac and the fact that they had been importing this tea with that label into Australia. Whether it was decided that no action would be taken against them, but whether or not they actually ever got back their lost tea was not a story that the archive, or not a question that the archives could answer. So one element that came out of these regulations is these many applications to use. The original ledger is on the left-hand side there, and then a complete listing from the Attorney General's Department for applications 1916 to 1918 is also available. In addition, military police at the time, or police at the time, were also tasked with noting down the use of Anzac, where it was being used in the community during patrols. So if they went out and they saw that a home had the name Anzac up at the front, or they saw that a business was using it, then they would create a report, and that report more than likely would find its way back to Robert Garran in the Attorney General's department. So the first, so what we see on the left here is the first page of a 3-page report generated for the use of Anzac in Sydney in August 1916. And it lists everything from the use of Anzac as the name of a home to the use of Anzac as the name of a fish shop, for example. And it goes throughout Sydney as well, right from the CBD down to Newtown and then out to the coast as well. Some addresses not far from my institution are actually on this list for the nefarious use of the word Anzac. Once this was received, once this information was received by Robert Garran, he would then send these early form of cease and desist letters telling individuals to stop using Anzac, generally within 14 days of receipt, or they would face legal action. And then the first or the final limb was prosecutions. Now, there weren't a lot of prosecutions for use of the word Anzac. There were other things going on, so there weren't too many prosecutions. But the prosecutions that occurred are interesting circumstances. Here, the Anzac Art Photo Enlargement Company. This was run by James Armstrong, whose brother was a soldier. And on being notified of his infringing use of the word, Armstrong changed most of the material in his photo studio, except for a few frames. When the police came to interview him, they saw those frames and recommended prosecution to Garran. Armstrong was found guilty. He was set a fine and costs. He paid the costs almost immediately, but then asked for a reduction in the fine. And he said, my brother is an Anzac. I didn't do this for any misguided reason or for any false reason. But Garran, being a direct and very legal man, said, we're not going to waive this fine. The other example was Frederick Rogers, who ran a Cafe Anzac in Port Adelaide, and he was also prosecuted. He got dobbed in by one of his neighbours, an individual who sent a 2-page letter to the Attorney General's department identifying that this cafe was using that name Anzac, but also noting the fact that Frederick Rogers was a name change. The gentleman had previously had the surname Spiegelhalter, a German surname. So, in addition to investigating this use of Anzac, the police also investigated this former German surname. He was only prosecuted, though, for using the name Anzac. And again, it was quite a minimal fine. In contrast to some of the other fines at this, or the applicable penalty under the Act at this time could be £100 or 6 months imprisonment. In both of the cases of Anzac, the fine was about £1. So it was a very minimal fine. Fines for £100, those quite large fines and periods of imprisonment, were mostly imposed for seditious behaviour, for not supporting the war and being vocal about it. So all of this is happening within a very short space of time in 1916. The first set of regulations, as I said, were introduced in July 1916. And so a lot of what I've spoken about happened in the second half of 1916. But then in September, October 1916, it was decided that those initial regulations did not go far enough in covering how Anzac was being used in the community at this time. It was also being used as the name of charities, and these might have been legitimate or more nefarious charities, and it was also being used as the name of individuals' homes. So often a family member might name their home at the request of a soldier or in honour of a soldier who may have passed away either at Gallipoli or as the war continued. Now, this regulation provided that without the permission of the Governor-General, you could not name any private residence, boat or vehicle Anzac, and there were a few boat or vehicles. There were also a few Anzac cows, but I won't be covering that today. And it also made it an offence without the permission of the Governor-General to name any charity or other institution Anzac. And that's where all those letters that I mentioned at the beginning of the talk came into play. These family members writing these quite devastated letters, mentioning a loved one who was serving, who may have died, and every time receiving the same standard form letter from Robert Garran that permission would not be granted. Now, with the commercial regulations, the reason they were introduced were, for the most part, on account of the fact that the government was seeking to protect this word from overuse, or to protect the sanctity of the word. At this time, it had become, by mid-1916, even earlier than that, it had become a sacred word within the community. This prevention of misuse argument was more difficult to justify in the case of naming homes Anzac. Now, on the left-hand side is one of the few newspaper articles that actually discusses the introduction of this prohibition on the use of Anzac as the name of a home. And it quotes Garran, who stated that, well, you know, tens of thousands of people would be able to call their homes Anzac if we let family members call their homes Anzac. And that was true. But as I mentioned before, in the National Archives, there are probably only about 70 of these letters of application. So it's not as though everybody with a loved one was seeking to name their home Anzac. But a fantastic memo, and occasionally I do wonder if this actually will be the best thing I ever find in my career, and it's all downhill from here, was a casual memo written from Robert Garran to, I believe, one of his friends. And he talks about this regulation. His friend has got in touch with him to see if he can assist with permitting a woman to be able to call her home Anzac. And Robert Garran says the equivalent of, well, look, mate, no. Because, one, we've found a lot of people are doing it. And, two, we've actually found that a lot of German people are doing it. So there was, again, this German element to this regulation. We're in 1916, we're towards the end of 1916. October 1916 is where it starts to get very difficult for German and Austrian members of the Australian community. And while I don't think you can argue that this regulation was created solely on the basis of this German usage, it was an influential factor. And I believe to suggest otherwise would deny the importance of what was going on during this period. Now, this was all happening in 1916. The war finished in 1918, though officially didn't finish in Australia until 1920-1921, when that act of war was repealed. So, as I mentioned before, the regulations on Anzac were created and passed pursuant to the War Precautions Act. And the government decided to repeal the War Precautions Act under the aptly titled War Precautions Act Repeal Act of 1920. But in that act, they also included a series of powers, or they designated a series of powers to the Governor General that allowed the Governor General to continue to do certain things that he had been able to do during the war. And this included the restrictions on the use of the word Anzac. So the protection of the word Anzac regulations were then passed in 1921. And these put into place the regulations that had been in force during the war, that restriction on commercial use, no use as a trademark, no use as the name of a house, no use as the name of a charity. It was repealed later in the year to include no use of Anzac in relation to entertainment. That Act is still in force today. Those regulations are still in force today. And that is the only part of that War Precautions Act Repeal Act that is still in force. To the point where in 2014, the Abbott government actually renamed it the Protection of Word Anzac Act. But in many ways, this was a very hollow action because the real guts of the law is in the regulation themselves. The regulations have been amended a number of times over time. In 1959, a restriction was introduced on the naming of a road Anzac. This had previously been okay, and that's how you get places like Anzac Parade and a lot of different places called Anzac in the community. But a restriction on that was introduced in 1959. In 1979, we actually saw a relaxation of the law that we continue to see today. So while I was driving over here, I had a fantastic drive through Brisbane. I hadn't actually ever been through Brisbane, and I noticed there was an excellent pub culture that I could see. And outside these pubs, there were a lot of Anzac Day advertisements. Come join us for Anzac Day. We'll be doing two up from we'll be playing two up from 7:30 in the morning. Come and join us. Now that was actually the exemption introduced in 1979, that you're allowed to use Anzac when you're advertising Anzac Day activities. And then there were a number of minor amendments made later on. In addition, two states also introduced their own legislation restricting the use of Anzac. When we talk about this period, there was a lot going on, or there was a lot of uncertainty about the relationship between federal and state power. And as I talk about in the book, I'm not entirely convinced that the federal government actually had the constitutional power to introduce the regulations that it did. But I appreciate it's 6 o'clock on a Wednesday night before Easter, so we're not going to quite delve into the constitutional aspects tonight. I wouldn't do it to you. But because of this fear that the federal government didn't have power, two states decided to introduce their own laws, South Australia and Tasmania. And I'll come back to Tasmania a little bit later on. And then finally, there were customs restrictions introduced as well, that you couldn't import any materials using the word Anzac into Australia. That would also be an offence. So you get that series of restrictions, still restricting commercial use, use as a name of a home, use as a, by a charity, importation restrictions as well. So let's return then briefly to Anzac biscuits, because it was during this wartime, post-wartime period, that the Anzac biscuit that we know today began to take off. So to the right-hand side, I have a couple of recipes for Anzac biscuits, and these were quite commonly printed in newspapers at the time. The one at the top is from the Argus. It's from the early 1920s, and that's the earliest Anzac biscuit recipe that I can find, or a recipe for the way that we would have them today. On the left-hand side is an advertisement for a bakery that sells Anzac biscuits. This was incredibly rare. Bakeries weren't selling or advertising Anzac biscuits at this point. Women in their homes were making Anzac biscuits generally once a year around Anzac Day, but beyond that, it wasn't the all-pervasive biscuit that we know today. Because Anzac at this time was still that sacred word, and it's still sacred today, but it was still being treated in a way that had more in common with its protection in 1916 than how we consider it today in 2017. So I find this a really interesting counterpoint. In 1965, the 50th anniversary of the landing of Gallipoli, only one tangible item was created to commemorate that anniversary. And it was a series of postage stamps produced by the government. Now, not surprisingly, these became a collector's item very quickly. But How interesting that the only item, the only physical item that you could collect to commemorate this event was stamps produced by the government. And as you'll see, when you contrast it to the commemoration that occurred in 2015, it's like we're talking about two different words or two different issues. So these postage stamps were made by government. Nobody else applied. Nobody applied to the government to manufacture goods for the commemoration of this anniversary. It just simply wasn't done at that time. So, for example, during this period, we see in the documents, in the records on the use of Anzac at this time, we really see that rise of the RSL. For every application in the kind of 1960s and 70s, for every application the government received regarding the use of Anzac, they would get in touch with the RSL to get the RSL's opinion on whether this was permissible. And one company got in touch with the Attorney General's Department actually asking to make a commemorative medal for the 50-year anniversary of the RSL. And we can see it on here. It uses the Anzac in the left-hand side, that spirit of Anzac. So this wasn't even to commemorate anything to do specifically with the Gallipoli landing. It was to commemorate something to do with the RSL. But one member of the Attorney General's Department was absolutely scathing in what he thought this was about. And in a letter to the RSL, he stated that the proposal appears to me to be the most blatant suggested commercialisation of the word Anzac to have been considered, at least within the last few years, and has not been made any more attractive by any proposal to pay any royalty to the RSL, as any suggested royalty could well be interpreted as being the price for approval. Now today, if you make an application to use the word Anzac in some commercial way, you are more likely to be granted that permission if part of the money you raise from that enterprise goes to the RSL. So in 1966, we have a member of the Attorney General's Department saying how repugnant this practice is. And then 50, 60 years later, one of the things, as I'll show you a little later on, that the Department of Veterans Affairs takes into account is whether there will be some kind of financial benefit to the RSL or a number of veterans organisations. Now, during this time, we return to Anzac biscuits, and the only application that I have found in the National Archives relating to Anzac biscuits and their use and use of the word Anzac. So, and it comes back to that classic American company Tupperware. Tupperware had created 86,000 pieces of 86,000 pastry sheets that included an Anzac biscuit recipe on them. And they wanted to be able to distribute them in Australia. So the Attorney General's Department, and this is the serious with which this issue was taken. This is a full two-page, tightly printed memo on this issue. The Attorney General's Department gets in touch with the RSL. The National Secretary comes back and says, Anzac biscuits are an old favourite of mine, so look, this is absolutely fine. But this, and the application for Tupperware is ultimately granted. But this is the only application up until the late 1970s, when records in this area stop because of document timing restrictions. This is the only mention of Anzac biscuits in the legal history of the word Anzac. But in the mid-1980s, it was discovered that that pesky Tasmanian legislation that I mentioned before was still on the books. So Tasmania had simply forgotten that they had passed this law in 1921 that made it a crime in Tasmania to use the word Anzac. And the first line up there actually identifies the fact that it's illegal to sell Anzac biscuits in Tasmania. Well, the fact of the matter is it was illegal anywhere to do so, given the federal restrictions. But shortly after, the Tasmanian legislation was repealed and the South Australian legislation was repealed, leaving the federal legislation the only legislation in continuance. Now, it's from this time that we start to see the commercial rise of the Anzac biscuit, and as I said beforehand, that commercialisation, or more importantly, that permitted commercialisation of the word Anzac by the government. So the first company to actually manufacture commercial Anzac biscuits in Australia was Unibic. In conjunction with the RSL, they became the official kind of supplier of these Anzac biscuits in Australia. And every year they produce a fantastic tin collection. And the tins are collector's items. You can buy them on eBay, both with and without the biscuits inside. I'll let you decide which you would prefer. But this was the first company to make this product and to sell it on a commercial basis. And from there, it grew. I'm going to come back to Anzac biscuits in a minute, but before I do that, I want to give you a bit of information about applications to use the term. And a reversal in practice that occurred basically 100 years apart. If you applied to use the word Anzac in the period 1916 to 1928, more often than not, you were denied. If you applied to use it in some commercial way, more often than not, you were denied. And then conversely, if you applied to use it in some commercial way 2006 to 2015, more often than not, you were permitted to do so, you were allowed to do so. And I'll stop here and I'll say, there are a number of, all of these uses are legitimate uses that we know have not damaged this term in any way. And many of these uses were not for commercial purposes. They were for commemorative activities that you still needed to get permission from the Department of Veterans Affairs in order to be able to use that term. And I go through the list of applications. I received the list of applications for that 2006 to 2015 period through a Freedom of Information request to the Department of Veterans Affairs, my first FOI request, and it wasn't even good info about me that the government had. It was about Anzac applications. And these are listed for the most part. There are some limitations on what the information tells us, but a lot of the people or a lot of the companies seeking to use Anzac were RSLs, soldiers' organisations, libraries, museums, local councils to commemorate the use of, to commemorate the Gallipoli landing. But it's an interesting juxtaposition and it's very clear on that graph. 1916 to 1928, you were not going to be able to use this word. 2006 to 2015, the odds were in your favour. So when we break it down even further, that 1 year period leading up to the 100th anniversary of the landing at Gallipoli, once again, we see overwhelmingly that you were likely to be permitted to use the term Anzac. Now, that orange bar is a tricky one because we don't actually know who wasn't allowed to use the word Anzac and what purpose they were seeking to use it for. Because under the Freedom of Information Act, that kind of personal information is exempt. If the application was rejected, then there are privacy reasons why that material has been exempt. So there were a number of applications, they were rejected, and clearly they were not within what the Department of Veterans Affairs felt was appropriate commemoration. Returning to the Anzac biscuit, Anzac biscuits over the last, that kind of 10-year period, accounted for about 10% of applications to use the word Anzac. And it might be more because it might be that actually an RSL was seeking to use the word Anzac because they were going to be selling Anzac biscuits. But about 10%, from the information that I've received from the Department of Veterans Affairs, it was about 10% of all applications. So we see this movement from it being a people's biscuit through to a commercial product, accounting for 10% of all these applications. to the point where in 2013, 2014, Senator Michael Ronaldson, who was the Minister for Veterans Affairs at the time, while I was writing the book, the Minister for Veterans Affairs changed three times. And that's not because I was writing the book over a long period of time. That was 8 months. It was Ronaldson up until September 2015. What happened in September 2015? The Liberal spill. The Stuart Robert then took over as Minister for Veterans Affairs. He stepped down in February 2016. And then Dan Dehan took over in February 2016. If the Liberals had lost the federal election, that would have been 4 ministers for Veterans Affairs. But I was thrilled that Dan Dehan stayed in, because otherwise my book would have been out of date before I had completed it. So a lot of love there. So in 2013-2014, Senator Michael Ronaldson was actually called to account in the budget, in a budget estimates committee, asking, well, actually, how many people have you allowed to make Anzac biscuits and to use these names? So in this official parliamentary document, we get everything from Starbucks to Coles to Kmart, all these different companies who have been permitted to make these products. So I just want to finish up by talking a little bit about how decisions regarding Anzac are made today. In June 2016, for the first time in 100 years, that isn't an over-exaggeration, for the first time in 100 years, publicly available guidelines were released by the body overseeing use of the word Anzac. So for the first time in 100 years, you were told what you had to do in order for your application to be compliant. As you can see from all the highlighting, I got very excited by this because it was literally the first time in 100 years that any detail had been given about where you were more likely to be permitted to use the term, where you were less likely. If you wanted to use Anzac in relation to a tobacco product, that wasn't going to fly. Any kind of gambling product, again, no, that wasn't going to happen. The guidelines also detailed what sort of criteria you have to satisfy today in order to be permitted to use the term. The idea is to, when you make an application, the following factors will be considered: the intent of the legislation to protect the word from misuse or overuse, any commemorative link between Anzac and what you are doing, the views of the defence community, whether an ex-service organisation will benefit from that use, commercial aspects, and any commemorative or commercial benefits. So in that 100 years, once again, we see not only that change in treatment of the word Anzac, but that change in what will be taken into account when the government is looking at your application. Now, it's not considered that if part of your funds that you raise from that will go to an ex-service committee, that is not as repugnant as it was treated in 1966. That is a benefit. And to highlight simply how important Anzac biscuits are in this area, the guidelines also cover Anzac biscuits not only once but twice in the regulations where they apply. So you have to get permission if you are fundraising, if you wish to use Anzac in a trademark, if you are producing Anzac biscuits. And then it dedicates a whole section to Anzac biscuits itself. Most importantly, that you will name them Anzac biscuits, not Anzac cookies. That's a big no-no. You can call your child Anzac, but do not call them Anzac cookies. And on that note, I will finish up. Thank you very much.
As well.
Excellent, thank you.
The mic?
Yeah, do we just need to turn it?
Oh, fab. Thank you. Thanks, Brooke. I think press the green light. I've been informed that it will be...
Thank you very much for that fantastic historical sweep of the evolution of the term Anzac. Just to kind of kick off questions, there's a kind of a good chapter within the book that explores some of the comparative treatments in relation to the term Anzac and looks at how it's dealt with in Australia versus how it's dealt with in New Zealand. Yep. And how the United States also kind of deals with it. Yep. And I was very kind of struck visiting the Te Papa Museum in New Zealand, how the Anzac legend takes on quite different connotations and forms in the context of New Zealand. Yes. So their big exhibition with bigatures and that was put on with the help of the weather workshop developed quite different national mythologies in relation to the concept.
Thank you for bringing that up. So one of the chapters in the book covers the regulation of Anzac, both in New Zealand, how it's done in New Zealand. It's restricted legally there. It's also subject to legal restrictions in the UK. And in the United States, Australia kind of went for more of a diplomacy approach to approach companies using the word and kind of persuade them not to use it. New Zealand is a really interesting counterpoint because obviously they have more letters in that acronym than we do. But Australians are without a doubt guilty of Australianising the everything that comes with Anzac. So in New Zealand, they went for a softer approach. And not only did they go for a softer approach with the regulation, but they also went for... They went for an approach that I think really shows how they understood themselves and how they continue to understand themselves and their history as a nation. So, for example, the regulations were introduced just after the ones in Australia, and it was decided, for example, that while it would be restricted as a commercial term, there would be a special carve-out for things like badges and brooches so that people could still do that. People wanted to be able to do that, wanted to be able to signify what their loved ones were doing, and so they carved out an exception for that. So in my mind, it was a far more realistic and slightly more permissible set of regulations. But as I said, they also recognised where Anzac fit within their history, and they weren't willing to sacrifice other elements of their history to Anzacify everything, so to speak. So there was an application to rename a street Anzac, and a very passionate letter by a gentleman saying, well, actually, this street was named after a great Maori. And it was argued that, you know, this contribution of the Anzacs doesn't change what that individual did, and it shouldn't be changed because of that. And the government ultimately agreed. So I think because New Zealand already had such a great sense of self-identity at that point, they obviously were extremely proud of their contributions and what Anzac stood for. Whereas we in Australia, because this was, as is often said, this is the first time we were tested as a nation in war, we really grabbed onto that more than New Zealand did. And I think that's reflected in the regulations and what was allowed or what was not allowed.
Questions, comments, queries? Dr. Kate Devitt? We're just going to use the mic so the recording can be.
It was a bit crazy when we were coming in. Thanks.
Test it out. Is that working?
Yeah, excellent.
Thank you for Marvel's presentation. So I was just wondering, in your uncovering of these incredible stories and evidence, do you feel that there were any kinds of evidence that you couldn't find that you wished you could find in order to service any of your arguments? So, for example, I was wondering about thinking of the New Zealand culture versus Australian culture. We have this sort of tradition of a larrikin culture too, and I could imagine quite a few people flouting the rules, but they're not necessarily being the document trail. Of Australians not obeying the regulations, but then kind of also hiding their their tracks?
Yeah, look, that's a great question. Look, the one thing I wish there actually was more of, just on that point, was I wish there was actually some reported case law. It would be fantastic to see how judges would have dealt with this issue. On the point about whether actually there was usage and people were using it and they were just escaping this attention. Look, I think that's right, but I don't think it was to an extent, I don't think it was to a significant extent. So, for example, one thing I was able to do was compare applications to use Anzac for books in relation to applications to register the word copyright to register Anzac in relation to a copyright work, so as the name of a book. And there were certainly books that appeared on one list that weren't appearing in the other, so people were just ignoring the regulations. More generally, though, I think if people were ignoring the law, even if there's not a paper trail, because of that kind of community policing of the term, if someone was using it, that person was going to get a lot of pushback from the community. So, yeah, I absolutely agree. And the same with Anzac biscuits being sold and those types of things as well. That's not always going to appear in advertising. But from everything I can put together, you can see different patterns emerging. But yeah, there's always a few more things that you wish you could find. Not sure I could spend any more hours looking for things though. I've got a lot of stories.
Wrong way. Sorry, Brooke.
Thanks, Kathleen, for
this
very interesting presentation. Well, from your presentation, I conclude that Anzac really famous in Australia for the trademark, famous trademark, but it might be not so well known trademark in the whole world. I imagine if there are some people in some countries using the word Anzac for their trademark.
Yep.
And then their products are totally widespread all over the world and highly demand on this product.
Yep.
And then some of Australian here would like to import their product.
Yep.
So what is the regulation according to this Anzac trademark?
Yep. So I'll pull apart a couple of things there. So with the issue of Anzac being a trademark, as in 2003, Australia and New Zealand petitioned the World Intellectual Property Organization to have the word Anzac added to a list of things, a list of words that can't be registered as trademarks. So even though, for example, in France, I was recently going to be travelling to the battlefields of France, and of course there's like the Anzac Hotel there because you're getting all these Australian tourists coming in and, you know, oh, it's the Hotel Anzac. So the word Anzac can't be registered as a trademark in any country that adheres to this list. But that's a great question about, okay, so if I make this amazing Anzac product in America and want to import it here, can I do so? No, because the customs regulations that from 1956 are still in place. You can't import those goods into Australia if they're named Anzac. And actually, when Australia was dealing with this issue with the United States, one of the threats, they didn't have any legal grounds, but one of the things they would say to people using this term was, well, if you try to import these goods into Australia, you won't be able to. So if you keep calling it this, you'll never be able to join the Australian market. So we've protected our, we've really covered all bases with the protection, definitely. Good lawyering.
It's a bit curious. I mean, you talk within the book about the protection of national icons and the very disparate treatment of national icons in Australia under intellectual property.
Yeah.
And it seems a very sui generis approach in relation to the Anzac term.
Yeah.
Professor Pat Ofterhoek.
Thank you.
So I'm just fascinated with this. And thank you so much for it.
No, of course.
So I was intrigued by the petitioning process and the response. Was there any kind of like more public discussion than was hinted at in those letters in terms of somebody saying, "How dare you tell me what I can name my house," or anything like that?
Yep.
And did that was there any public discussion that surfaced later?
Yep.
And pushback also after 1960,
when they cancelled the trademark? The companies pushed back and they cancelled it.
Yeah, sure. So the answer is very simple. No. It's amazing. There really wasn't. It was in both in relation to the issue of the trademark cancellations and more generally in relation to that public discussion of, well, who are you to tell me what to do? On the issue of the trademarks, a number of individuals, and including soldiers, did get in touch with the government and say, look, I've put all my money into this. You can't just cancel my trademarks. But the government said, well, unfortunately, that's the case. But nobody ever raised this in a public forum, in a public discussion. And I think that has a lot to do with the fact that we were at war during this time. And people didn't want to be dissenting about something that the government was doing. Last week, I had the pleasure of hearing Professor Joan Beaumont, who's a leading Australian historian at the Australian National University, talk about this issue. And she said people were so compliant and so patriotic during this period that actually they wouldn't have dared to do this, to talk out about this. One thing that I raise in the book, as I kind of hinted at before, is the fact that I'm actually not convinced that the government then or now has the power, the requisite constitutional power that it needs to in order to regulate this area. All it would have taken was one person in World War I to challenge these regulations, to say, actually, I don't think it is within the defence power that you're allowed to tell me I can't call my home Anzac, and no one ever did. We just simply didn't have that culture at the time.
But later on, it continues to be regulated.
Yep.
Later on, does anybody say, you're stopping ordinary business from happening?
No. And today the case is actually not that you're stopping businesses using this. It's thank goodness you're stopping businesses from using this. Thank goodness that these restrictions are in place. So that public discussion never occurred, whether in the community or in Parliament, because these were regulations, so they were never debated in Parliament before, our equivalent of Congress. And that's part of the story itself.
Nick Sousa?
Thank you. I have two quick questions. Yeah. Thanks so much for the talk.
Thank you for having me.
Brilliant. The first is, do you have the record? Did Woolworths have to get approved, and do we have the record of the decision-making process that allowed Woolworths to make the...
So Woolworths... what should have got permission, or the reporting at the time said Woolworths should have got permission. I'm not actually convinced Woolworths needed permission, but that's a whole other talk over drinks, folks. It's a whole other academic journal article. So no, they didn't. And we also don't actually have any evidence of how the decisions are made now. We have the list of who's allowed to use it, but the Department of Veterans Affairs never releases the actual decisions, so we can't tell how they're taking the different factors into account.
And they're not available on the record?
No. Well, I'm not sure what documentation the Department of Veterans produces when it makes these decisions. Yeah.
And the other question, I swear I'm not normally this law academic.
Yeah, Flair Bart.
Tell me about the Constitution.
Yeah, sure.
Does the Payment Commission of the Taxation provide an implied mention?
That's a great question. So just briefly on the constitutional issues. At the time, during World War I, the government and Robert Garran basically assumed that our defence power, which gives power to the Commonwealth to make laws with respect to the military and defence of the nation, believed that the that power gave them the requisite constitutional power they needed to pass whatever they wanted to do or do whatever they wanted to do as long as it was related to the war. Now, I think there's actually a better argument today, given the development of constitutional law, that it's probably valid today under something like there's a whole chapter of this. This was the hardest part of the book, not the 100 years of legal research, but figuring out how Australia's constitution works. I think there's a more valid today, given changes, more valid argument today, given changes in how we think about the constitution, that it would be valid today. Because if, you know, the government can pass laws with respect to mandating certain things about the way the Australian flag is used, etc. So today, probably the more likely, but in the past, I think there are a lot of questions about whether they actually had the power to do so. I'll leave it there because I don't want to be cruel to attendees. Angela, I know you love the Australian Constitution. We're going to talk more about this. Yeah. I'm just going to talk.
We're saving the discussion about the vibe.
Yeah,
after
yeah,
drinks.
Yeah. More the better, honestly.
In your research, is your research just pertinent to the word Anzac, or did you come across any links with, say, the SAS or NATO, that perhaps those acronyms could be utilised?
That's a really good question. So Anzac is for the most part just really one of a kind, and the regulation of Anzac is for the most part one of a kind in that it not only stretches across commercial use but also stretches into that private sphere as well. With things like NATO, those other acronyms you mention, for the most part we might see them restricted as they can't be like registered as a trademark, for example, or you might not be able to get a business name registered with them. But Anzac stands alone as that most regulated term. I think I need to look into whether you can call your house Olympic. I think you actually might be able to, but you know, I realise I'm being recorded, so they'll probably introduce a restriction on that soon. Yeah, that's, yeah.
Day
yep.
has evolved and played out over the decades.
Yeah. Yeah, I definitely think that element is there. I mean, if you want to use the word Anzac in relation to Anzac Day, you don't have to ask permission. So you can just automatically do that. That's not a problem. You don't have to get in touch with the Department of Veterans Affairs. But certainly I think, I think that connection is probably there, definitely. And we just can't make it out or can't explore that in any more detail because of the limited information that we can get on applications, really.
Yeah, I was just interested in the statements about compliance. And compliance society we were back then. And
yep.
When Anzac Day was formulated, very serious day.
Yep.
And it still is, but it's,
it's changed, absolutely, yeah.
I wonder if there is a parallel to be observed in how willing people are to give, the government is to give approval for the usage. There's a different flavour around
Anzac. Yeah. And I think you're really onto something there, and not only kind of the relationship between Anzac Day, but also commemoration at Gallipoli too, the idea of the young person's Gallipoli pilgrimage to go to that beach where Australia was born. I mean, there are so many books about Gallipoli tourism. And, we know that we know that 42,000 people applied to be on the beach for Anzac Day 2015. I was one of them. I reached number 17,000 somewhere, but 8,000 people were, 42,000 people applied for 8,000 places.
Dr. Angelo?
Okay, so not a question about the Australian Constitution, but actually kind of related to some US constitutional thinking.
Yep.
So I don't know, are you aware at all of the US First Amendment scholar Eugene Bullock?
The name sounds familiar, but I couldn't recite off the top of my head. But let me tell you an Anzac biscuit recipe now. No. That I can do.
Okay, it's a very quick point, actually. And so he has more in his blog, but he has a category of what he terms of as kind of secular blasphemy laws, which is a kind of a rather incendiary term, because he basically doesn't really like such laws, so that's why he calls them secular blasphemy laws. But I think things like the restriction of the term Anzac would probably fit within his category.
Yeah.
Particularly, I think, in the US context, he looks at things like, or attempts to stop flag burning, which actually is protected by the First Amendment.
Yep.
But he's looked at kind of, in the UK context, sort of desecration. So the words are even very sort of religiously imbued of poppies.
Yes, so yeah.
I think if you're not aware of the term, I think you should maybe kind of think about it for the future.
No, I will. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.
No, I appreciate that. I was familiar with the name, but I'll have a look at more at the work. And I've got a great little book from the UK called Poppy Gander, which kind of talks in a similar, isn't that a fab name? Which talks kind of not about the legal aspects of it, but that idea of poppy as a propaganda, the poppy as a propaganda symbol, and what it means as a cultural memory symbol, etc. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Dr. Carly Paplan.
I had a couple of questions.
Great, okay. No problems.
The first is about your book cover.
Yes.
I think it's beautiful.
Yes.
Particularly for an academic book.
Yes.
I was wondering, firstly, I assume you had to get permission for your book title?
Oh, okay, that's a good question. Okay.
Secondly, is there a story behind this picture?
Okay, so I'll start with the second question first. The image is from the Australian War Memorial, and it's a group of soldiers in France in kind of the last days of the war. It was taken by an Australian official war photographer, but they're not actually sure who it was who took this image. This battalion, the Billy Hughes scarecrow effigy that you see here, that was actually their mascot. So I like the kind of ambiguity about the image, because you see it and you think they are hanging the Prime Minister, and they are hanging the Prime Minister, but they're actually doing it because he is their mascot. They would string him up whatever town they got to inspire them. I'll say one other thing about the book cover too, which is that the gentleman in the jacket has the Anzac A badge on his sleeve, which means that he was at the landing of Gallipoli and then straight to the end of the war when this image was taken in 1918. The Australian War Memorial are fantastic, and I asked them all sorts of questions about the authenticity of the image, and they just work their magic. Now, the question about whether I had to get permission. Okay, so I emailed the Department of Veterans Affairs, because I'm the diligent legal academic that I am, and I was told I didn't need permission, which I found really interesting, because I couldn't see, so I'm just going to flick back a bit. So I can call my book Anzac, that's absolutely fine. But why is it then that Zoo Weekly has to get permission to use the word Anzac in the context of its special Anzac centenary issue? So I couldn't figure out what was the distinction. They weren't calling it, they weren't renaming Zoo Weekly Anzac Weekly. This was something that doesn't actually even, the word Anzac doesn't actually even appear on the cover. But why was it a problem that they didn't get permission, but I needed to get permission? That's a question for another day.
And one more question.
Go ahead.
About permission. So
yep.
Pat and I are working on a project and need to.
Yep.
around copyright permission.
Great. Yep.
Interviewing particularly.
Yep.
Documentary filmmakers.
Yeah, sure.
Historians.
Yep.
And I was wondering whether you had any issues with the letters you reprinted in your book and all that about any of that.
No. So all of the letters and that sort of stuff that I've extracted in the book. So, for example, these kind of lists, okay? The National Archives Australia, probably relying on Section 200AB or whatever, or another provision, has no problem with us reproducing this type of material. I think I actually started timing how long it would take them to get back to me, because once they got back to me with permission within 4 minutes of me lodging the application, they are very happy for us to for you to use this copy, this material, the copyright protected and unpublished material too, which is interesting as well.
So the National Archives owns the copyright?
They wouldn't own the copyright.
So how can they give you permission?
Well, that's a good question. It's
in the letters too.
Oh.
Surely those are
Yeah, the police documents, the personal letters, well, technically they're unpublished works. I don't actually reproduce any of those kind of photographs in the book, but I do reproduce some sentences and some replies. But no, for the most part, there were no issues whatsoever. I will just say, interestingly, I mentioned this in the book, New Zealand, though it was very different, I applied to get permission to just access one of the New Zealand files, and it was 100 years old, but I was denied on the basis of legal professional privilege. So everything in the Australian archive is open, and there's some really damning stuff in there. We have Robert Garran saying that Germans are using this word and that's a really bad thing, whereas New Zealand, I couldn't actually get access to all the materials, which was unfortunate. But they got back to me to tell me no really quickly, which I appreciated.
Just a final closing question. Yep. Maybe it'd be worthwhile to kind of swoop back to your initial kind of context and thinking about intellectual property as a weapon of war.
Mm.
In addition to the trademark and business and secular blasphemy battles over Anzac, it seems to me that there are lots of interesting intersections, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Battles over confidential information from the Spycatcher case and Pentagon papers and WikiLeaks.
Yep.
Lots of battles over copyright in relation to government information.
Yep.
Historically, lots of interesting controversies over patent law and compulsory licensing in relation to defence.
Yeah.
Everything from the Wright brothers to dealing with bioterrorism scares.
Yeah. Yeah.
I just wonder what thoughts you have in terms of your future explorations of that field, or have you developed a new love for writing microhistories and you're working on your next microhistory?
It's actually possibly a little bit of the latter there. One of the things that I really enjoyed about in doing the Anzac work was actually a lot of the personal stories that came out. And so the next thing that I want to do is actually kind of a series of legal biographies. And I use the term legal biography here to talk about people's experiences with law rather than them being a judge or a lawyer, etc. So people who during World War One were arrested, like Adela Pankhurst, the daughter of suffragette Emmeline Pankhurst, or many of the German Australians who were interned in Australia during the war. And so putting together a much more complete legal history of World War One, but through the lens of actual lived experience. So once again, a very different development in my career to my area of research. Thanks.
We'll just wrap up. I'd like to thank Dr. Catherine Bond very much for coming along and talking about her new fantastic magnum opus about Anzac, and particularly timely, just before the Easter break and Anzac Day
itself. It is coming up, yep.
Think about these sorts of issues, and you're quite right that Brisbane has been particularly enthusiastic in pursuing these issues, with the front page of the Courier Mail today promoting the sale of commemorative Great War Anzac medallions.
Yep, Legends of Anzac.
You've already
medals.
Discussed the propensity of Brisbane bars and pubs to promote their two-up. But such has been the enthusiasm about the topic, I was very disappointed that my the present that I wanted to give you was already sold out at the local Australian Post Office, where you had this whole platoons of teddy bears and array of other kind of commercial products in relation to Anzac. Well, my personal gift
That's
is
very kind of
another
you.
Anzac history.
Excellent.
To complement your own Anzac
Thank
history.
You so much.
And I think, much like the American Civil War, the Anzac story is tells a whole myriad of different sorts of stories.
Absolutely.
And
thank
tales.
You so much for having me.
So thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.